There have been tremendous developments in the field of cardiac surgery. Hi, I'm Dr. Randy Martin, and I want you to imagine what it would be like if we were able to assemble some of the world's top cardiac surgeons and cardiologists to discuss the latest developments in the Ross procedure, and you were able to visit with them and learn from them. Thanks for joining us. Let me ask you, you know, here we are, three cardiologists, and I showed this thing last year where I interviewed some of our interventional fellows, and they didn't even know what the Ross procedure was. Do you think in the general cardiology community that people know what the Ross procedure is now?
Oh, I bet they don't. I bet there's still a lot of unknowns and maybe misunderstanding about this because it's not in the mainstream of most cardiologists' repertoire.
You spend a lot of time with house staff too. Do you think they, I mean, do you ever discuss it?
Sure, and they go, really? I think valve disease in general is becoming an enormously complex area that is going to require more and more dedication to it as a sub-specialty to really understand all of the nuances. So not just the Ross, obviously, with TAVI, and other areas of valve disease that are not in the mainstream of cardiology, but are becoming so.
If you look at I think the concept of durability of valves, reoperations, all those sort of things, I think most cardiologists would say, gee, a mechanical valve lasts the longest, but you've got to, you know, be on anticoagulants and all that stuff. Do we have good longevity data and freedom from reoperation on tissue valves, I'm not talking about the Ross and mechanicals now, that support the concept that they last a long time?
Well, we have the data, and the freedom from reoperation for a mechanical valve is not zero. There clearly is a reoperation rate for mechanical valves, and so the idea that they last forever just isn't correct. They last longer usually than bioprostheses, depending upon the age of implantation.
Well, I think that's the point, because the current generation of bioprostheses do have a pretty good track record regarding durability, even in people under age 65. So if you were, again, dealing with the issue that reoperations do occur,
right?
If you were a 50-year-old man, you might go for a bioprosthesis for lifestyle issues. So you don't have to deal with the complications of under or over anticoagulation. And so maybe you've got a 60% chance that the valve's going to go for 20 years, 40% chance you may need a second operation at some point in time. But the lifestyle is quite important for patients.
And now people say, well, gee, you know, I can have a TAVI valve inside that tissue valve. And we have absolutely no evidence of the applications of that for
not
durability.
Not yet, but maybe they're right.
Maybe
technology is going to catch up.
No, you may be right. You may be right. But, I mean,
we already have reports of essentially valve in a valve for every valve.
Yeah, right.
And just the question is, okay, those are reports. Now, how would those reports translate to everyday use? I don't think we could.
And
once done, what's their durability? Is it 1 year?
Right.
Is it five?
Right. You know, how many valve in valves can you have?
I mean, it's right. Like the shrinking. It's like you and me, the shrinking, shrinking men, shrinking orifice. Let's go back then to the Ross procedure, because it certainly there is some data on its survivability, its freedom from reoperation.
Yes.
Hanukkah and Magdi have a nice thing, and Magdi just had an article in Lancet. I mean, do you think there is beginning to be data on the durability of this and this, you know, long-term survivability of this?
The survivability data are quite good.
Yeah.
These are relatively small studies. When you add them all up, mm-hmm. the survivability is good. Now, these tend to be young people who don't have a lot of other comorbidities, which may also explain why it's survivability is what it is. So I think that's true. Now, again, these are excellent centers that can provide an excellent result and get it published, but that may not be true everywhere. The durability is one of the concerns, but it gets into the issue that there's no perfect valve, and many patients will require second operations at some point in their lifespan. But the issue with the Ross procedure for most cardiologists is the complexity of this and the complexity of what they have to deal with afterwards. They're going to have to now follow a patient who's got two different valves that need to be followed. And again, unless you get it done perfectly, and there are surgeons who can do it perfectly, you're going to have to follow patients who now may have problems in either side of the heart or both sides of the heart. And we've all seen patients who've had Ross procedures done where the results were less than optimal. On the other hand, I've got patients who've had Ross procedures who are just doing fine. They got a normal heart. Their echoes even look normal, and they're leading totally normal lives. So many years out. So the idea again, as Blase indicated, let's identify the centers of excellence to refer our patients to where we can achieve the best results.
And even among the experts, there isn't one Ross procedure. It's not an electronic ignition that you pull off the shelf and stick in your car.
Right.
Even among the very top surgeons in the world, there are nuances about differences about how they perform that operation, just like among great golfers. Their swings are not identical. And so you've got to take that into consideration as well.
You know, I mean, I think it's somebody, I think of John Brown in a conversation with him, made a great point that not every mitral valve repair is the same, and that if you look at the data from guys that have done a lot of these, Tyrone, even though he says he's not doing it currently now, Sir Magdian, that their outcomes are good. So the question would be, if the Ross has durability and certainly has some good long-term data, should it be done by every cardiac surgeon or selected surgeons, or should there be a very few who do a lot?
Blase go first on this one. We both want to weigh in on
this.
Yeah,
I mean, if it were done by every cardiac surgeon, the results would be disastrous. This is a complex procedure that requires dedication. Somebody to say, this is going to be my area of expertise. I'm going to dedicate all of my skills to learning it. The first couple I do are not going to be as good as the last couple that I do, and that I'll learn as I go. But if you don't do that, I mean, the outcomes will not be good.
We learned at a recent valve symposium that the average surgeon in the United States replaces eight aortic valves, eight per year. So that's probably not the average surgeon's cup of tea to do a Ross procedure. So we need to concentrate the patients who would benefit from a Ross procedure, mostly young people, to send them to the places that can do it the best and develop what would be considered a center of excellence for that procedure.
It's an interesting we've argued this for mitral valve repair, the same thing. I mean, not argued, but discussed it. It's an interesting concept of if you're a cardiologist in a town and you've got cardiac surgeons there that support you when you're in trouble, and now you're going to send a patient out for an elective procedure. But I think from the patient standpoint, that's what you're arguing. We really need to send them to people that dedicate themselves.
It's an interesting dynamic. I mean, we kind of make that point in the guidelines regarding mitral valve repair.
Right.
You know, it's if not enough repairs are being done and not enough good repairs are being done on the mitral side, is that a problem for the surgeons or is that a problem for the cardiologists who refer the patients to the surgeons? The same thing is true for the Ross procedure. I mean, I have a selected surgeon who I've sent a few patients to. I'm in Chicago. The surgeon's in New York. And the patients have done great because I've selected a person who can do a great job. And you know, it's Dr. Stelzer. He does a phenomenal job.
And that in no way abrogates your relationship with your surgeons in Chicago. They don't hate you for that.
No, and the patient helped decide what they wanted done.
We'll find that out when he gets back to Chicago.
Maybe so. But I think that we all have an obligation to develop and continue collegial relationships with the other professionals with whom we practice. We always will always have the most important relationship with the patient.
Yeah, that's what I'm going to say. You're doing what's best for the patient.
Right. Do the best thing for him or her.
And the patients are informed. The patients say, I heard about this Ross procedure. Is that an option for me? It may not be usually in my discussion with the patient, but the person who knows about this wants this procedure done. Let's talk about that.
Well, let me ask you this because, you know, I know you guys are some of the authors of the guidelines, and I just read the bullet points on the guidelines. I don't read the whole thing. And you just told me that the Ross procedure is actually in the guidelines. Is that correct?
The guidelines are in fact, a textbook of valvular heart disease. And if you read the between the lines,
are you accusing me of not?
No. If you read the whole all the text, it really is a terrific document. The problem is that it's much easier to read the bullets, the specific in black. These are class 1, class 2A, class 2B recommendations. That's often as far as some folks get, and I think that's sad because the people that hashed those guidelines out spent hours and hours and hours perfecting that. that verbiage.
Much.
So the things we point out are the advantages of a Ross procedure.
So, okay.
Okay, especially for a young person who wants a normal lifestyle. No anticoagulation, great hemodynamic performance
right.
for someone who's exercising.
Right.
No need for kinds of drugs you worry about in pregnancy. So
right.
it's terrific for a woman who wants to become pregnant. For a child, the valve will grow as the child ages. So for a pediatric valve surgeon, this is a great opportunity to do the right thing for a patient. And we discussed that. We also discussed, though, that there's some issues regarding durability. We need more data regarding survival and durability. Of course, those guidelines were published in 2006, and more data has come out
sure.
subsequently. But the point we made was now, if more data come out indicating where this particular procedure, which has great potential, fits in, it's conceivable that one would not only consider recommending that procedure for some patients, but maybe in general lower the threshold for when you would recommend that patients have their surgery done in the first place.
Okay.
If you have an option to provide the patient with a operation which is going to work.
You know, I know when you explain it to people that, you know, cardiologists, let's say, or fellows or people like that, they say, gee, this is, we're doing two valves for one valve? It sounds a little complex. I mean, if you were explaining it to a patient, how would you counter that?
Well, I think just as Bob said, the idea being, though, that in the high-pressure, difficult zone, you put a valve that you expect to grow and mm-hmm. to live and to do quite well, and that the homograft in the pulmonary position doesn't take as much heat, so it should do well, too. That it is, you know, when you think of Donald Ross conceiving of this in the era before cold cardioplegia is really pretty amazing.
It's pretty amazing. It really is.
But in fact, a good Ross surgeon will tell you that one of the important things is not to be in a hurry, that this is a complex, difficult thing, and you have to explain that to the patient
right.
too. But it's a harder operation for greater gain on the other side.
If Bob, you raised the question about more data, and there have been now some 10-year
yes.
longer follow-up
right.
sort of things. So if the data in the right hands, okay, so the right surgeon, the data begins to look good, how do we get the knowledge about what the procedure is and the advantages? Because you mentioned, you just, you know, ran off a couple of pretty good advantages for the procedure.
Yeah.
How would this get out to our colleagues and to the consumer in a, you know, good way?
Well, it needs a little bit of more prime time in the medical journals. Sir Magdi Yacoub, has a randomized trial comparing the Ross procedure to a homograft in The Lancet. Okay, that's on the front page of every internist in many places in the world.
Right.
And so that's the kind of information that needs to get out there. It also needs to be assimilated, and a meta-analysis that's been done recently, which takes some small studies, puts them together into a larger database, showing that as you said, you know, greater than 10-year, 15-year survival. Now, whether that's better than the patients would have achieved if they had a different kind of operation, it's not clear. So randomized trials are quite helpful here. Now, the durability issue is one that's got to be kept in mind, but even those data vary. In some centers, the durability is terrific.
It looks pretty good, yeah.
At after over a decade. In other centers, there's an attrition rate. So again, we're dealing with some of the technical things that Blase talked about from
Absolutely.
Surgeon to surgeon. We can't address those points, but I think we could address the point that this is an excellent option for patients if we can identify the center in that person's neighborhood that is best at doing this, and maybe it's not in the neighborhood at all, maybe a different city.
But and cardiologists and surgeons need to work together not to make the same mistake twice. We did this 15 years ago. There was a big spate of interest in the Ross about 15 years ago where it became the flavor of the month, and I think that did lead to some poor outcomes.
Right,
because this is not, you know, the tortoise and the hare. This is for the tortoise. This is for somebody who's...
The good tortoise. The very technically good
expert tortoise that is slow and steady, that wants to dedicate his or her life to doing these. And if you have that technique, that dedication and that technical expertise, the outcomes, I believe, will be good.
What about, you know, we live in an age of Google everything. So should there be, should the good tortoises put together a website that gets good information for people versus an individual marketing website? You see what I'm saying? I really think the consumer, and Hanuk and I were talking about this, is that we have an obligation to the consumer to give them shared decision-making tools and give them good knowledge. So question would be, should you design a website for the consumer to talk about it, the options for aortic valve replacement?
That might help, especially if it's not marketing a single individual or single center. I think what would help would be for some of the professional societies, and it's already starting to happen, professional societies to start establishing what is needed to become a higher level center of excellence for valve disease.
Okay.
And then within that framework, you decide, here's a mitral best quality,
right,
and here's aortic valve best quality, including Ross procedures, and establish what that is. And then get that on the website. Here are the centers that achieve these particular metrics.
It's difficult. I mean, anybody can say that they're a center of excellence. Heart center here, heart. I mean,
we have a lot of those.
Heart hospitals.
You got to do more than talk the talk. Yeah. You have to be able to walk the walk, and that should be based on outcomes of that center. Show us your bona fides. Tell us about how you're doing.
Okay.
I think there's, for the consumer, it's a real problem. The average, I think, American spends more time figuring out what $17 toaster he's going to buy than which kind of heart operation he should have. And that's probably because it's easier to understand toasters than it is to understand pulmonary homographs. But still, we have to, as a cardiology community, help to inform patients. Hopefully they'll come to us.
In a way, they understand it. That's important.
Yeah. I mean, I think we're still at a stage with the Ross procedure where even the expert surgeons who do great work don't agree on how to do it. And until...
You mean technically?
Technically.
Okay.
Technically.
Right.
And there's different ways of going about it, as Blase was saying about the golf swing. And their outcomes may be equally good. But if it's not consensus about what the procedure really is, to try to grow that amongst surgeons and to create a center of excellence concept, could be a little more difficult.
And then there's something that we haven't dealt with, probably because we don't know how. And that is, the assumption is that these successes and failures are built upon the surgical skills and the devices used. We haven't talked about the patient. The patient has his or her own biology, which interacts with that aortic root, which interacts with that
pulmonary
homograph. And there's stuff in that patient's genes that we don't know, I don't mean like this, but like their genetic makeup, that we don't know anything about, that has to in some way predicate the outcome of that operation. And those are also, or hopefully, areas that we'll begin to explore as we go forward. Even a plain old bioprosthetic valve. Why does it last 20 years in one 50-year-old and 10 years in another?
Right,
the valve came off the shelf the same way. What happened there? That's the patient's biology that we don't understand.
Okay. Well, listen, I appreciate you visiting with us. This isn't
the Bob and Blase show.
This isn't the farewell tour
or
of
the Blase and Bob show.
The Blase and Bob show, whichever happens to be.
Your roadies will be here in a little while to take you to the next city. Thanks for visiting with us, though. Seriously, that was good.
Thank you, Randy.
So I've had the opportunity now to visit with the world's experts, and it's given me a whole new perspective on the Ross procedure. What have I learned? I've learned that in excellent hands, and that really is the key, that you have excellent surgeons doing the operation, selecting candidates the right way, that this is a great operation, because it offers durability and it offers something that we don't think about too often, which is really quality of life issues. I think in the United States, this really needs to be on the horizon of both the surgeon and the cardiologist and the patient. And it's probably going to require that we educate ourselves first, the patients in a secondary fashion, but make the patients be joint in their shared decision. And it's going to require, I think, that we have expertise in selecting the right patient. That means cardiologists have to get actively involved in this. And then tremendous expertise in having the right surgeons do this initially. Is it a trainable technique? Yes, it is. But I think we're going to have centers where this is done. But I am totally convinced now, sitting here looking at the data and listening to the colleagues and having a chance to visit with them, that this is a tremendous operation when done well, and it offers patients a tremendous quality of life.